Hey guys, welcome to round one of this pre-TQ. We are going to keep this on the draw. Mana looks good, a little bit painful, but pretty good. We're really looking for some kind of a mill spell, like a Satyr Wayfinder to turn the Murderous Cut on. That or a Sidisi, something to find soul would be really good. A turn two courser is also very strong. I am not upset at the prospect of having a turn two courser with this hand. That sounds awesome. Temple of Mystery out of the opponent, not quite sure what that implies. It could just be a control deck over there. Sultai control, it's probably the most likely. Oh, he's fetching. Maybe just so that he can F6 here. Maybe because he's got like a nullify or something. Definitely not a nullify. Whisperwood Elemental on top. Exactly the card that we want to draw against control. That's a perfect card. Ashiok. Okay. So that's going to exile the Whisperwood. So we can attack it back down to 3. We'll play Sea Drino. I think we're in okay shape. I can't actually play the Yavimaya Coast off the top and still play the Sea Drino. That's really awkward. If there was an Urborg in play, it would work out. Or if the forest was a dual land, or if the Elvish Mystic was a Sylvan Caryatid. But we definitely need to get this Sea Drino into play. It's like our only real hope of pressuring the Ashiok. And he's probably going to uptick the Ashiok anyway to exile the Yavimaya Coast. So I think this is okay. In our piddly little one life that doesn't really matter in this matchup. Get this Sea Drino into play. I was really looking forward to drawing that Whisperwood Elemental. Ashiok was a really good strong play there. So yeah, here, if he can use a solid removal spell on the Sea Drino, then he should be in really good shape. Like Hero's Downfall, Sea Drino, or Sultai Charm It. I guess you can't Sultai Charm It. It has to be single color. Looks like he's just doing it as a sorcery. Yep, there's the Hero's Downfall. We draw another courser, Sea Drino on top. We're not gonna draw that Rhino, unfortunately, but I'm gonna run out this second courser, play the Sandstep Citadel, and serve in. Yeah, the Ashiok just removed all of my pressure. Which is pretty brutal. And here, if he plays like a Crux of Fate, it'll be hard to imagine winning. Like, we'll probably just lose to the Ashiok. Ashiok is one of the reasons that I set aside the kind of self-mill decks. They tend to perform particularly poorly against it. Another Soul of Theros on top. Yeah, I'm just going to serve with everybody here. No real reason not to. But think about how much damage we would have gotten in if he hadn't played that Ashiok on turn 3. This could be like, you know, Bile Blight. I could fizzle that by Murderous Cutting my own courser. That doesn't really help the situation. It just means that we would get in 3 damage to put the Ashiok to 1. I'm just going to let this happen. He's down to 2 cards in his hand. So if for whatever reason those 2 cards were not very exciting, then I guess I could see us winning, maybe. We're not beating a sweeper any way, shape, or form, so I'm just overextending here. Play to beat what you can beat. Don't try and play around cards that win the game for your opponent on the spot. It's not very useful. But if he did just have to, like, make a creature here and try and come up the board. Tygam Scheming. That's interesting. So I guess he's, like, trying to set up his next turn. Maybe Fuel a Delve spell. I don't think I've seen Tygam Scheming in anything. And it makes me, like, reconsider the composition of my opponent's deck a little bit. Yeah, there's Satyr Wayfinder. It's probably just there to fuel more Delve Draw spells than the typical Sultai control deck is running. Like, he probably just has, like, two Schemings in there. And then he can run Treasure Cruise alongside Murderous Cut and Dig Through Time instead of just running Dig Through Times, which the which that deck is typically known for running. Think he milled four cards. Seems right. Cast Tygam Scheming. This doesn't tell you. Pay attention, you noob. We're just not gonna make that clear at all. That's fine. I guess we could back up through his turns, because he hasn't really played any other self-mill cards, I don't think. Yep, he is getting a creature off of Ashiok. That's a really good sign for us. He's gonna get a Caryatid, sure, and he's down to one card in his hand. It's interesting to note that if we played Sylvan Caryatids of our own and we wanted to get his off the board, we could. I mean, obviously we do play Sylvan Caryatids of our own, but if we were playing Bioblight, we could Bioblight our own Caryatid, and get his out of the way. Let's see. So I want to leave back enough creatures to cast this here Soul of Theros. I think I'm actually going to lead with the Soul. Because how my opponent reacts, like if he plays a counterspell on it or something, then I'll know that I only have to send two creatures at the Ashiok instead of all three to play around a removal spell. So I think this is good. And there's only one counterspell that would have hit it, but there's, I mean, I don't think there's a reason to hold it for the second main. And if I did this attack and held an Elvish Mystic back, then he like kind of knows that I have a purpose for that other Elvish Mystic, and then Bioblighting them seems a little bit more lucrative. I don't know. We might see an Ugin here, which would be pretty brutal. Appears that's what my opponent is casting. Yeah. So I kind of like playing the Soul of Theros. I think that was correct because it makes him downtick the Ugin from six instead of just three. So it's a little bit more possible to beat. But it doesn't seem very likely. But at least our opponent is hellbent. We're gonna draw this Commune with the Gods. We're gonna find a Satyr Wayfinder. Which is not exciting. However, it will give us our fifth mana source and bring us closer to casting the Soul of Theros. So here, if we draw a sixth mana source off the top, we'll be able to cast Soul next turn, and that can potentially just beat Ugin by itself. If we draw Sidisi, that might provide like multiple threats to beat the Ugin. It looks like he drew something, Satyr Wayfinder. Yeah, we don't care about that. If the Wayfinder could be a good blocker, we would just Murderous Cut it. It's not like this Murderous Cut is doing anything else. Sidisi, that's a good draw. Assuming that we hit a creature. If we don't hit off of the Sidisi mill, then the Ugin can just uptick to kill it, but we hit, so that's really good. So he can just untap and like uptick the Ugin to kill the Sidisi. But at least it takes some of the pressure off of our life total. We've taken a decent amount of damage just from tapping our lands this game. So he activates, the Ugin goes up to five. I'm gonna Murderous Cut his Wayfinder at his end of turn, or even just right now. I mean, he's hellbent. There's no reason. It's not like we're playing around anything. It doesn't matter what we mill. You just want to mill not souls. You don't really care about the rest of it. Siege Rhino, that's a good draw. And then this bad boy is going to attack Ugin. And now Ugin will not be able to downtick four to kill the Siege Rhino. So it can uptick to kill the zombie. And we can attack Ugin down to one. And assuming our opponent doesn't draw like a Dig Through Time or a removal spell here, we could actually win this game. Yeah, Ugin's at one. Just gotta fade this one more draw step, or like maybe hit that sixth land so that we can cast Soul. That would be really good. He's doming me, okay. Playing a land. That's a really good sign. If he'd had the scry land last turn, he would have for sure played it. So that was like almost definitely his draw for the turn. Cause you want to get the scry, you wanna set up your next draw. I want to find an answer to this Siege Rhino. Oh, that's such a good draw. All right. We have successfully ground through an Ugin. That is not common, in case you were wondering how common that was. Not very, and we are now representing lethal. Opponent plays another land. The Opulent Palace is one that he could have been sandbagging, but it's kind of unlikely. Tapping some mana. Sultai Charm. Is he drawing? Draw two cards and discard a card. Well, he definitely should have cast the Sultai Charm before playing a tapped Opulent Palace for no reason. Because, like, he probably wants to discard that palace. Like, we're at the stage of the game where it's just not that useful. Okay, and he scoops to the onboard lethal. So I want to look at his milled cards here really quick, and yeah, it looks like he's just playing a very typical Sultai control deck with some Tygan Schemings thrown in. So, hey, sorry about that. There was a problem with my hard drive. Sometimes my hard drive fills up and then it makes me stop recording and stuff, so we didn't get to see the sideboarding process. Basically what I did was I cut the elves. I shaved away one of the souls. Here we can actually just look at the deck. What I did was I cut the elves. I shaved a soul, and I cut these murderous cuts. All pretty lackluster cards against the control matchup. The elves are a little bit more lackluster than usual because they don't do well against opposing sweepers if he's playing like Crux of Fate and stuff. Whereas the Sylvan Caryatids you want to keep in just because they're good at fixing your mana. They're a little bit more necessary. Whereas the Elvish Mystics are mostly here for explosive factor. And then what we board in is the four Thoughtseize and all the blue cards. And that's it. That was what I did. Anyway. So here we are, game two, opponent mulliganing. We are gonna keep this. This is a pretty ideal hand. Assuming the Satyr Wayfinder finds us another land drop. You usually want to start with if you don't have an elf, starting with it comes into play tapped land is a pretty good opener. Yeah, so here we can go Wayfinder into Courser, into Hold Up Negate for some Planeswalker or other. I almost want to Hold Up Negate on turn two, just so that he can't just slam an Ashiok on me. I almost considered boarding in the Banishing Light. Just so I could answer a turn three Ashiok much easier. I'm gonna play the Wayfinder though. We don't win this game if we just sit here holding up a negate for forever. Just gonna run the old hope he doesn't have the turn three Ashiok plan. Yeah. So we can't play Opulent Palace and Hold Up Negate here, because then we won't have a blue up. There is a little bit more consideration to holding up Counter Magic here, though, as opposed to last turn, simply because it's not just Ashiok anymore. Now it's Ashiok or Kiora. So just going like... I'll trade off. It's fine. Ooh. Well, that's a really good draw. Gives me information and stuff. I think I'll Thoughtseize here, play Yavcost, and then next turn, Courser into Opulent Palace, depending on what he does. Yeah, I think this makes sense. It's just a Hero's Downfall on some lands. Alright. I do like seeing that. So we're not even going to Hold Up Negate, even though he could rip one off the top. I'm just going to play the Opulent Palace, just have a slightly better curve, I guess. Make sure that we're going to play a random Planeswalker off the top. I don't think it really harms us to do so. Like, it's not like we're going to go 4-drop, 5-drop, or anything like that. We're either going to go 3-drop tap land, or we're going to go play a 2-drop that we draw off the top. Still be in fine shape. Let's see. Windswept Heath, okay. Yeah, I'm gonna play Courser now. And then next turn, we can play this Whisperwood Elemental. Yeah, definitely playing this. So we didn't get the Opulent Palace down, but I don't think it's necessary. Something that I kind of like in this deck, and really any green deck right now, is the synergy between Courser and Whisperwood Elemental. Because you play the land off the top with Courser, you're more likely to manifest a creature. It's just, okay, there's an Ashiok. That's fine. Fine thing for our opponent to play. At least we know he doesn't have a removal spell in hand, and we are in a position to actually pressure it, because we know this Whisperwood Elemental is going to resolve. So we should be in good shape to grind down an Ashiok here. And then that'll be 2 games in a row if we do that. Although pre-board grinding down a Nugin, at first grinding down an Ashiok and then grinding down a Nugin was pretty brutal and very unlikely. I think the only way that happened was the opponent never drew a Dig Through Time to just fire off a pile of removal spells and gain control of the game. Like, he really just had a Planeswalker heavy curve that didn't actually offer much protection. Okay. Can I beat this? Can I just beat this Siege Rhino? Is this a beatable card? We have a Treasure Cruise. What are we going to do with this Treasure Cruise? I kind of just want to, like, play a second Whisperwood Elemental. I might do that. We can pay 3 for Treasure Cruise, though, and hold up Negate. That's kind of nice. I guess then we would have to play the Mana Confluence from our hand. But maybe that's fine. The thing is, I would like to play the Opulent Palace off the top of our library. I think we're going to be in good shape regardless. So I want the Treasure Cruise to resolve. So I'm going to play this Mana Confluence. Even though we're not getting Courser value, I think that's just fine. We're going to lose a little bit of life. Oops. To fire off this Cruise. Yeah, those are some Soul of Theros. Alright. Okay. Now I think I'm going to end up losing a Courser here. I could actually... Nah. Just to get the Ashiok off the board. I must discard. Oh no, what will I ever discard? Yeah, I like that a lot. So we manifested Thoughtseize, right? Yeah. So we've got a sweet Opulent Palace Thoughtseize going on. This next turn, we're going to untap. We're going to have 7 sources. So I think I'm just going to fetch and play second Whisperwood Elemental. And then I'm just going to line up Lethal by exiling the Soul from the graveyard. And I think that's just fine. I don't think I need to cast the Soul that's in my hand to win this game. Always important to make sure that you actually have a land you can fetch with this deck. Because when you're self-milling, sometimes you hit those basics. And there's only 4 fetch lands, and there's only 4 lands to get. So, looks like my opponent wants to do something in response. And it looks like he's attempting a Dig Through Time. Yep, that's what's going on. 1 card left in hand. Which is a very easy negate target. No real reason to attack yet. Whisperwood Manifest goes off. And we can even just attack this next turn. So we're protected against sweepers, because he can't play the 5-mana... Well, I mean, if he played the 5-mana Wrath, we would go down to a single Manifest. But that's still... It's still not nothing. Oh, it's a Siege Rhino, too. We have a Siege Rhino and a Sidisi Manifested. Those are some good Manifests. I don't think I'm actually going to use them. I could just unflip both of them, I guess. Get more stuff. Yeah, so we were protected against Ugin. We weren't really protected against Crux of Fate, but he didn't end up having one, so... Yeah, I'm just going to attack with everything... force a Siege Rhino block. Exile my soul. And then play a Sylvan Caryatid in my second main phase. So that way... is this lethal? I don't think it is. 4, 8, 16 plus 6. It's actually... Yeah. Yeah, that's exactly lethal. This is Xaxes if he doesn't have anything. I thought I was going to be like a point or two short, but I didn't actually count. Cool. Well, there's the match. How about that overfilling our hand with treasure cruise to get Soul of Theros in the yard? I liked that. Whisper to Wood Elemental is nuts with this deck. Usually, the only downside of Sidisi is that you have to actually attack with her. This was actually the first match I've played with Whisperwood Elemental in this deck. I saw the version that did well at the GP, and I wrote about it earlier this week, but I hadn't actually gotten a chance to get some games in. So I'm pretty excited right now to see just how brutal this card was. Like, our opponent had a Siege Rhino that stopped us from attacking, and it just didn't matter. We just killed him anyway. And if we'd only had the one Elemental, and we'd need more turns to set up, then that would have been fine too. We would have just manifested up some creatures and gone to Pound Town. Anyway, see you guys in round 2.